Again, thank you for joining in with us, some perhaps on recliners, some love seats, some couches, maybe around the kitchen table. Perhaps you're in the vehicle headed down the road listening in. Appreciate you tuning in this morning, however or wherever that may be. It is a delight to, again, lead us and worship together. I've asked the Lord again this morning to be a blessing in and through these services. I've asked him particularly this morning to just visit you where you're at this morning, and that he himself would fill your heart, his Holy Spirit would bless your life where you're at there this morning in such a powerful and instrumental way. And now to lead us in worship this morning.
Power and
morning, and thank you again for joining in with us this morning. Praying this message will truly be a word of encouragement to your life, a blessing. A message that I've entitled, My Portion. It's hard to believe, but this is the 9th message in our Corona Quarantined series. And I'm taking us to the Psalms this morning, the 16th chapter. So if you have your Bibles, will you grab them and turn with me to the 16th chapter of Psalms. Preserve me, O God, for in thee do I put my trust. O my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my Lord. My goodness extendeth not to thee, but to the saints that are in the earth, and to the excellent, in whom is all my delight. Their sorrows shall be multiplied that hasten after another God. Their drink offerings of blood will I not offer, nor take up their names into my lips. The Lord is my portion of my inheritance, and of my cup thou maintainest my lot. The lines are fallen unto me in pleasant places. Yea, I have a goodly heritage. I will bless the Lord who hath given me counsel. My reins also instruct me in the night seasons. I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad, and my glory rejoiceth. My flesh also shall rest in hope. For thou wilt not leave my soul in hell or the grave. Neither wilt thou suffer thine Holy One to see corruption. Thou wilt shew me the path of life. In the presence is fullness of joy. And at thy right hand there are pleasures forevermore. Father, this morning, again, like at other times, we need you. And we need you to speak through your word. And we ask, Holy Spirit, that you would do that so kindly, compassionately, gently, personally in our lives. We pray that again your word would be illuminated before us. I pray truly it would be common, and that truly it is that lamp unto our feet and light unto our pathway. Oh God, this morning you know the direct contact of every heart, every family, every relationship, every mom, dad, boy, girl, son, daughter, whoever it is this morning that your word falls in the deepest parts of our heart. God, may it truly minister. And you know the areas that it needs to minister and move. And so we ask that this morning, in that mighty name above all names, in the name of Jesus, we pray. We're in quite a unique time, to say the least. Our culture has been adjusting. Our world has been adjusting. Our communities have been adjusting. Our churches have been adjusting. I've even heard that yet there is no great supply of toilet paper. So we can even safely say that there has been and continues to remain a shortage of toilet paper. But the biggest crisis of all is that there had been such a great shortage of frozen bread dough. And to me and my family, and to you and sometimes your family, that meant no sticky buns. Because that's what my wife uses to make those precious, delightful, sweet treats. But we have our hands on some now. But there's been a shortage. How about things that are even unavailable? Do you need a freezer? I sure hope not. I've heard that there's none to be found. There's none available, nor anytime soon. This particular psalm, Psalm 16, contains some of those life verses. Those verses or verse that you've ran to in a difficult or different season, maybe even right now, that we're able to run to. I want to walk through this chapter 16 and certainly not be able to do it justice or be able to glean all that it has to offer, but grab a few things this morning that would be a word of encouragement to you, and to look at what there's no shortage in, praise God, and to see exactly who there is an amazing availability with. I think that we are in times that it seems especially that it's easy for us to lose our godly perspective. Just this past week and all along the last several weeks and months, I have been too, but especially this past week, I've just been thinking about and thinking through many of the adjustments that we have had to go through and to make in our lives personally, in our lives communally, and even worldwide. the difficulties that people have seen and are continuing to see, the hunger in people to fellowship in the church, the ministries that are struggling and some that will not simply survive all of this, the people that are grieving over loved ones that have not been able to have that final closure and that final goodbye and are wrestling with those difficulties. Yeah, it's very easy to lose heart. Psalm 16 is a prophetic word as well. We read through it and we won't touch much on it, but in the 10th verse, David is mentioning about the Holy One, and he's talking about the Messiah to come. And over in the New Testament, in Acts chapter 2, we see Peter on the day of Pentecost even bringing this very scripture up and quoting it. And then even Paul later in the book of Acts as well refers and quotes this very scripture. And it speaks of the Messiah. But mostly what I want to look at this morning is David as he stares at his amazing God. And the amazing remarks that not only he speaks with his mouth, but also that you can see, feel, and hear as it comes from his heart. And I think we need to see that this morning. David says in verses 1 and 2, basically, I have you, Lord. And I have no good apart from you, Lord. It is an amazing word to be spoken. It is a reality of his heart and his faith. But it's something good for us to see this morning in verses 1 and 2 when he's crying out in declaration of the Lord that the God, that he would preserve him and he has put his trust in him. And he says, oh, my soul, thou hast said unto the Lord, thou art my God. And then he is going on to say that I have no goodness past your goodness, God. I have nothing apart from you. Everything good came from you. Oh, when I look at my life, when I look at that in my life, I see the goodness of God. When I look at that in my life, I see the goodness of God. When I look at this in my life, I see the goodness of God. I hope this morning that you also can relate at that and this in your life when you stare at it and you see the goodness of it and you see the pleasure of it. I also hope that you can see that it is God. It is simply God. And I say that it is good and that it came from God. I hope that you can see that in you and in your life because God has been good to our lives. Even maybe the things that we don't or have not at one time said was good, maybe even in a season now in our lives, we can even look at some of those very things and say, I can see now it has been good for me. I can see that God was leading me through all of that. But let's be honest. There's things in my life, there's things in your life that really, if we stare at it and we're really honest with our feelings, can't much see the good in it. And I declare to you that I don't think until we get to glory will God only then, and if he does, choose to reveal to us exactly his plan and his purpose, will we then be able to say at that moment, yes, it was good for me. You, God, are my greatest good, David is declaring. You, God, are my greatest treasure. You are my all in all. If I had no other good but you, you still are my greatest good. Oh, may that be the declaration of my heart. May that truly be the honest declaration of your heart. Oh God, you have been good to our lives, not just in the recipient of all the benefits, but because of you, Christ. The gift of you, Christ, is enough, and it is absolutely good in our lives. And because of that, it is good. And if I had no other good, that would be good. Christ, you have been so good. You are still the greatest good in my life. I hope you see this morning. I pray you say this with your own heart, like David had said it in declaration of his own heart. Look at verse 3, which has been what I've heard most in our time away from gathering at the church. And it has been this. We miss the connection with other believers. There's something that is happening inside of the church house when believers that are loving and following after Jesus Christ connect together. There's something that is happening that nothing can substitute. It's what I've been hearing mostly. David said in verse 3, and I need you to see this morning, because he is not praising people, but he is praising God first and foremost, recognizing also people and underlining it. But to the saints that are in the earth and to the excellent in whom is all my delight. It's the same thing that we have been hearing, the same thing that I have been hearing with our being pulled away in fellowship of the church and the church house. David is saying the same thing because of God and that very common connection, that very common thing that pulls us together. I delight in being around God's people because they treasure us the same God that I serve, and there's something that's happened. It would concern me, to say the least, this morning hour, that if in this very situation that we're in, that if I did not hear that we entirely missed the connection of one another, it would concern me very greatly if it wasn't mostly what I heard, that what we missed is gathering together in fellowship as a family of faith in the house of God. It would concern me very much. Because David said, I find great delight when I'm around people that love Jesus Christ with all of their heart. I'm not talking about churchgoers, neither was David. He was talking about people that had been rescued by an almighty God. People that had found and fell in love with a God that actually loved them and cared for them. It was David that was saying, I delight in the presence of those people. Not glorifying them, but glorifying God. It is much like I have been hearing from you. It should very much concern us immediately for people that have a greater interest in fellowshipping with unbelievers, being drawn quicker to them than it is to people of faith. There is a great heart problem there. A great heart problem there. Look at verse 5. It is the bearing on which most of my message rests this morning. Verse 5. Probably your life verse, maybe a verse that you've underlined in your Bible, one that you've run to, one that you consider very often. David said, the Lord is my portion. The Lord is a portion of my inheritance and of my cup. Thou maintainest my lot. It is a direct connection to what he told, to what God had told Aaron way back in Numbers. And not only to Aaron, but all of his descendants. And I read that to you in Numbers chapter 18, verse 20. And the Lord spake unto Aaron, thou shalt have no inheritance in the land, neither shalt thou have any part or portion among them. But listen, he says to Aaron and all of his descendants, I am thy part, I am thy portion, and thine inheritance among the children of Israel. And my friends, that this morning is the very birthright of every born-again believer in Jesus Christ. It is for ours in the claiming that we too can claim, and I trust that you are claiming and you have claimed that Jesus Christ as well is your very portion. He is your very inheritance. It doesn't seem fair. It didn't seem fair in the book of Numbers that all the descendants of Aaron, including Aaron, would not have the inheritance of the land. They would not have the portions of the rest of the people had, but God stepped up, and God is altogether sufficient in himself, and he said, but you will have me to be your inheritance. And that absolutely is our birthright this morning, ours, believers in Jesus Christ, that we have the inheritance of God indwelling within us and claiming that in born again experience, knowing that Jesus Christ is our portion. And that is good. That is good. Understand how many things are close to you and I, portions, if you will, and they're not enough. How many things are close to our life in portions, if you will, and they're just not enough. They never fully satisfy. And no matter how many times I gather around the table, and I know some of you will laugh, but no matter how many, how big my portions may be, they temporarily do, but they never fully satisfy. I will always come back for another portion. I will always be assembled around the table again, and so will you. But there is something that does satisfy. There is a portion that I will never have to ask of again, because it is enough. Praise his name. And he is the only portion that will ever satisfy. This is the message. This is the message this morning. Outside of Christ, all other things, all other people, all other gods, there will always be a shortage. There will always be a shortage to satisfy. There will even be an unavailability to the meeting of your deepest needs outside of Christ. But the Lord this morning, He has promised to be our portion. And that is wonderful this morning. And because the Lord is our portion and can be our portion in that He is our portion, He it is that satisfies my soul. Because the Lord is my portion this morning, David is saying, and I am saying, and trust that you are saying this morning, He it is that is all I need to treasure. Because the Lord is my portion, He it is that it is all the good in my life. Everything good is because the Lord is my portion. Everything I enjoy, every pleasure I have, everything I cherish is because the Lord is our portion. He it is that has never had a shortage because He is our portion. He it is that is always available and always available to our deepest need, always available to our cares, and always available to our deepest woes and our prayers and our anxieties and our fears and all of our troubles. Because He's available. Because He is our portion. He is always there to make refuge for our lives. Oh, how good it is to know that God is our refuge in that He is our portion. When I needed to be saved from my sins, when we called on Jesus Christ and recognized that we were sinners and we needed to be saved, He rescued me, He rescued you from the destiny of hell. That's what we were deserving. That's where we were heading. He is my portion. He was my portion and He continues to be my portion. Has Christ been claimed to be truly your portion this morning? Is He your greatest good? Do you hold Him like the most precious? The most precious gift. I have to declare there is no portion. There's no part anywhere or in anything that will preserve you like David was declaring his portion will. Or that you and I can trust in like we can in the Lord. I want you to look at verse 8 yet. And David said, I have set the Lord always before me, because He is at my right hand, and I shall not be moved. I want you to think about what David is saying when he says, I have set the Lord always before me. That means, simply, He is at the top. He is always there. David said, I have set Him there. And then see, in the very last of that verse, it says, I shall not be moved, or translated, I shall not be shaken. I want you to think about all that does and has shaken you. There's a lot to think on. There's a lot to recall. That certainly has shaken us. And that does shake us. And to be shaken, we all have been. We all have been. But really to be shaken is also to rearrange this very verse. Consider. What is it that has shaken our lives? What is it perhaps in your life this morning hour that is shaking you? Causing you to be moved? Whatever. Whoever that shakes us, person, place, sometimes a thing, sometimes a memory, sometimes a past. Whatever it is to rearrange that verse, really. And it would be kind of read out like this. I have set whatever that is that shakes us, whatever that is that may be shaking you this morning. I have set that always before me. And it is at my right hand or at my side. And it moves me. When God is taken out of His place in this particular verse or any place in our faith, and God is taken out of His place, everything else is rearranged. And we need to see that this morning. When David is saying in this verse that I have set the Lord always before me, He is at my right hand and I shall not be shaken. If you're going to put the Lord where David was placing the Lord before him, before you, Can I say truly before you, all else is behind? Is this your case this morning? Is he your portion? Is Christ your greatest good? If yes, there is no shortage. And praise God, he is always an availability to your life, to your family. And I'm thankful for that. Then can I ask you something? Is there anything moving you this morning? Is there anything that is shaking your life this morning? Why? Can I ask you, is Christ before you? Is Christ before you? Verse 9, David said, because he is my portion, because I have placed him before me, because of all that I've declared in chapter 16, he says, therefore my heart is glad. I'm going to call my wife to the piano at this time. And I want to lead you in prayer this morning. Father, you know who we're speaking to this morning, and you know the lives that you connect with. And God, there's such a beautiful picture painted of you in the life of David. Him declaring, him calling on your name, recognizing you to be his portion. Oh God, I remember in your word it says, we're not to look, or rather we are to look on the things above, and not on the things beneath where rust and moth and dust doth corrupt. Oh God, to know you as our portion this morning, to know you as our greatest treasure, the one that came searching and redeeming our lives, the one that died in our place, the one that bore all of our sin on the cross. And for you to declare, for you to say, I'm available, I am without shortage, I am made an access to our lives, that we too, like David, could declare, he is our portion. Oh God, this morning, maybe there's lives this morning that have been shaken. Something's moved in. The uncertainties of our time we're living in, the pressures, finances. There's many things that shake us. There's many things that attempt to shake us. Oh God, this morning, I just pray and ask for help for individuals, families, maybe husbands and wives this morning that need this petition to be answered more than anything. But God, this morning, that we would truly affirm in our faith and in our prayers this morning that God, that you are before us. And it is declared and it is shown in your word that when you are before us, then we don't need to be moved. We don't need to be alarmed. We don't need to be shaken. Oh God, how good it is to know you as our portion. Lord, this morning, bring strength to my brothers and sisters in the Lord through this word. May we be reminded, maybe that would be the biggest thing this morning. May we be reminded the Lord is our portion. It is him we are relying on. It is him we are trusting in. Oh God, to know you are our portion. You are our greatest good. All the good in our life is because of you. The things we enjoy is because of you. God, give help. Give blessing upon your word. In Jesus' name. Amen.